Well, good morning, everyone. Oh, nicely done. You'll be happy to know our students are awake. So, it's great to see everybody here this morning at Gate City Baptist. If you're joining us online, hi. Kids Life will meet this morning. So kids, when you see the slide up on the screen, head to the side lobby. We'll take them over to the fellowship hall for a time of children's worship. Parents, you get to come pick them up when we're done. This is the fourth Sunday of the month, and ordinarily we would have the fourth at 4 this afternoon, but we're pushing that till next week. So fourth at 4 next week. I hope you've marked your calendars to join us on December 9th and 10th for our Christmas production, Changed by the King. That will be at 3:30 on both days. It's free. You can come both days if you want. Invite your friends, your family, anybody you can think of. And to help with that, we have these invitation cards out in the Welcome Center. So if you want to pick some of these up and take them with you, stick them in your neighbor's mailbox, leave them when you go to lunch, leave it on the table for your waiter, waitress. Get the word out. We'd love to have this place packed out for that. The fun continues. The holiday fun continues on Friday, December 15th at 6:30 when we have our Holly Jolly Palooza. It's exactly what it says it is. It's going to be an evening of food, fun, holiday games. There might be some karaoke. There might be some singing with water in our mouth. I don't know. It's going to be fun. We hope you join. It's for everyone. This is not just a children's event. It's for all families to come and have a great time. There's no cost, but we would ask that you register online so we know how many people to expect. Speaking of holiday fun and knowing how many people to expect, please sign up for the Joy Group's Christmas dinner on Saturday, December 16th. That'll be at 5 o'clock. There's no cost for that either because we love you guys so much. But we do ask that you register so we know how many people we can expect at that Christmas dinner. Right now, I want you to take a look. Very special message.
Good morning, Gate City Baptist family. I hope everyone's doing all right. Just want to say thank you so much for your continued support of me and my one mission. I would also like to thank you for your encouragement and your prayers as we continue to work towards this lost community up here. I also want to introduce Mr. Shane Piercy, who is our partnership coordinator up here at my one mission. Shane.
Hello, good morning. Gate City, I just want to say thank you so much for your ongoing support. It was a pleasure to have Jamie up our way earlier in the year with Chad. And from that, we were able to, or I should say the Lord impressed upon Jamie's heart to send up on your own. Draven has been an absolute blessing to our church and to our mission. And I want to say on behalf of all of us at My One Mission, thank you so much for entrusting us with Draven. We love you. We thank you for everything that you do to help us see churches planted throughout Newfoundland and Labrador.
I hope everyone had a good Thanksgiving. I hope everyone goes on to have a great Christmas and New Year's as well. We just want to say hi from Newfoundland. I hope everyone's doing all right. Thank you.
Thank you.
I've known Draven since he was about that big, and he's much bigger now, and it's just so gratifying to see where he is now, and a lot of that has to do with all the people in here. So thank you guys for pouring into Draven and all of our youth. You can see how that works out. So thank you for that. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, now that we've all recovered, mostly, from our Thanksgiving feast, and we've had a chance to reflect on what we're grateful for, we can fully turn our attention to the greatest reason of all to be grateful, the birth of your Son, Jesus. I pray that as we navigate through the lights, the shopping, the crowds, the music, and the gifts, we would not lose sight of the fact that all of that is just extra. We know that the real gift, the real reason for this season, is the arrival of the Savior of the world. Help us to keep our eyes, our hearts, and our minds focused on the greatest gift ever. And now we pray that this time of praise and worship will be pleasing to you, and that we will use it to prepare ourselves for what you have to say. We ask all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning.
Am I the only one hoping Michael doesn't preach on gluttony? Ooh, it's a good weekend.
I've got some notes here from some things I was thinking about last night. I said, we've taken time over the last few days to consider some of the blessings and thank the one from whom all blessings flow. We could never make our gratitude list long enough to cover all that God has done for us, especially since his gifts are not just material gifts. We'd also need to include gifts like his grace and goodness and steadfast love toward us. Then, like an old Christmas song says, the best gift of all is Jesus. So Jesus, his life, his atoning sacrifice, his resurrection, our salvation, our forgiveness, etc., could also be on our gratitude list. In Psalm 106, 1 and 2, it says, hallelujah, or some say, praise the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Who can declare the Lord's mighty acts or proclaim all the praise due him? Please stand and join us as we praise God in song.
Well, Jesus is teaching, no one speaks like him. Choir, if you didn't have a reason to be thankful for this past Thanksgiving, that's a reason to be thankful that Jesus is living, he rose, and he's coming back again. But I don't know about you, I had a pretty eventful Thanksgiving. As I went to go light my grill, it blew up in my face, and to be honest with what's going on right here, I really didn't want to go out into public much. But I didn't have any hesitation coming in here to church this morning, because, you know, when you're with family, you just, however you are, you just come. And you know that you're going to be loved and you're going to be encouraged. In fact, I've heard so many encouraging things this morning. Somebody, I won't mention her name, but told me that the tryouts for Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer are starting pretty soon. You just can't get that anywhere. That's the kind of edification that we need, you know, to keep me humble. But I am thankful for this church. I am thankful for what God is doing for it. But I'm most thankful that we are a church that is about Jesus, that we are gospel-centered, that we're meaningfully related because of Jesus, that we're biblically grounded because it's his word, and that we are prayerfully focused on what he wants us to do. We saw a video earlier from Draven. That's just one example of how the Lord is using us here to reach the world. It's just amazing what he's doing. And so as we go into this Christmas season, as we were talking in Sunday school, it's easy to move from Thanksgiving into all of the things that we want. But let's continue this Thanksgiving. Let's continue this gratitude, this thankfulness for what Jesus has done, what he's doing, and what I am sure he's going to continue to do as long as we remain those four things: biblically grounded, prayerfully focused, meaningfully related, and gospel-centered. Would you pray with me right now? Father, thank you for this day. Lord, thank you for this church family. Lord, they're more than people. They're brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, I'm thankful that even as I'm going to spend eternity with them in heaven because of what you have done, Lord, I get to spend time on this earth with them now. Lord, help us to continue to grow in you, and as we do, to continue to grow closer to one another, Lord, to continue to be on mission together. Lord, this is not just a closed club, but Lord, we are looking to reach those that don't know you with the gospel, with that life-changing, eternity-changing gospel message. So Lord, help us to continue to be grateful for every blessing that you have showered upon us. And Lord, we pray that as we remember this season that's beginning now, that you're coming back, Lord, we just ask that you would come. Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
As the children are being dismissed to Kids Life, please stand and join us as we continue to sing.
OCD, somebody's got to fix the top of that Christmas tree. I just had to point that out. It looks beautiful in here. Above me, I've a good place to sleep. There is food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, as I struggle along, and they say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart I'm rejoicing, how I wish they could see. Yes, the clothes are new. I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you. And that's all that really matters, though the world may not see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings.
Whether or not you have read it, you got me there, Robbie. According to that, I am on test. There we go.
Whether or not you have read it or not, you are probably familiar with the play, Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet. Where am I at, Robbie? Okay, do I need to stay there? I'll stay right here. Anyway, whether you have read it or not, you are likely, in fact, almost certainly familiar with Romeo and Juliet. Even if you're not aware of all the details, you're aware that it's this love story. Now, I'm not some big Shakespeare fan or anything, but I had to read that in high school, either in my sophomore or my junior year. I don't exactly remember. But if you haven't read it, let me just go ahead and ruin it for you, all right? Romeo and Juliet are from families that are effectively feuding. So they hate each other. It's like a Hatfield and McCoy type situation. Long story short, the two of them fall in love with each other, but this is a forbidden love. Neither the families want to celebrate or welcome this at all. In fact, Juliet's family has arranged for her to marry someone else. To get out of this, she takes a serum that causes her to go to sleep in such a way that she appears dead for something like 42 hours. That's a good way to get out of your wedding. Just write that down. Appear dead. Anyway, So everybody thinks that she is dead. The problem is she did not let Romeo in on her plan. And so he discovers what he thinks to be her lifeless body, and he is so sick with grief that he gets poison and takes his own life. Well, Juliet wakes up, and she discovers that Romeo is now dead. And so she is so heartsick, in fact, so heartbroken, she stabs herself through the heart. The end. I remember reading that in high school, and I thought, what? This is the worst story ever. Because, like, as you're reading it, you're rooting for them. Like, and you're thinking, somehow, some way, this is like a Hallmark story before Hallmark showed up, but this is somehow it's going to end with a happily ever after, and there's going to be some twists and turns, but somehow they're going to wind up together. But then when Romeo dies, oh, man, that's terrible. Well, maybe Juliet, well, at least, maybe she'll find love again and she'll live happily ever after. No, shot through the heart. This is terrible. This is awful. In fact, there is a category for this. It's referred to as tragedy. It's a Shakespearean tragedy. Now, what is a tragedy? Well, at the end of the day, a tragedy is where something ends in a way that it either shouldn't or you don't want it to. So some of the ball games yesterday you thought ended in a tragedy, not how you wanted them to or how you thought they should end. That is a tragedy. Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet ends tragically. It has a tragic ending. We have for a number of weeks now been working our way through the story of Gideon, and the simple truth is I believe that his story has a tragic ending. And as we see how it ends, it's not how you want it to. It's not how I would want it to. It's not how God wanted it to, and it's not how it had to be. But in that, it's instructive because the reality is you don't know how much time it is that you have here and whether the Lord's going to come sooner or later or whether you're going to have a long life or a brief life. You have no idea about all those. But it is the case that you can operate in such a way that whenever your ending comes, whenever the story of your life comes to a close, it doesn't have to have a tragic ending. We can learn from Gideon thinking about this question, what is it that I may do that could cause my story, that may lead my story to end tragically? And if by identifying what those things are, I can decide not going to do that. So what are some things that may lead my story to end tragically? Look with me to Judges chapter 8, starting with verse 22. I don't know if your Bible has this. Mine has the subject heading above this passage, Gideon's legacy. We're told, then the Israelites said to Gideon, rule over us, you as well as your sons and your grandsons, for you delivered us from the power of Midian. But Gideon said to them, I will not rule over you, and my son will not rule over you. The Lord will rule over you. Then he said to them, let me make a request of you. Everyone give me an earring from his plunder. Now the enemy had gold earrings because they were Ishmaelites. And they said, we agree to give them. So they spread out a cloak, and everyone threw an earring from his plunder on it. The weight of the gold earrings he requested was 43 pounds of gold, in addition to the crescent ornaments and the ear pendants, the purple garments on the kings of Midian, and the chains on the necks of the camels. Gideon made an ephod from all of this and put it in Ophrah, his hometown. Then all Israel prostituted themselves by worshiping it there, and it became a snare to Gideon and his household. But Midian was subdued before the Israelites. They were no longer a threat. The land had peace for 40 years during the days of Gideon. Zerubbabel, that is Gideon, son of Joash, went back to live at his house. Gideon had 70 sons, his own offspring, since he had many wives. His concubine, who was in Shechem, also bore him a son, and she named him Abimelech. Then Gideon, son of Joash, died at a good old age, was buried in the tomb of his father Joash in Ophrah of the Abimelech. That's not the ending. Verse 33 contains the ending. When Gideon died, the Israelites turned and prostituted themselves by worshiping the Baals and made Baal-Berith their god. The Israelites did not remember the Lord their God, who had rescued them from the hand of the enemies around them. They did not show kindness to the house of Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, for all the good that he had done for Israel. That's not the ending I want. That's not, as the reader, the ending that you want. And we can't affect it for Gideon, but we can operate in ways that affect the ending that my story or your story has. And from him, we can think through this question and identify what are some ways that might contribute to my story having a tragic ending, and then decide I'm not going to do that. So what are some things that I may do that could result in a tragic ending to my story? Well, based on what we see here with Gideon, the first thing that you could do is this. Say one thing and do another. Say one thing and do another. All right, so that we're on the same page, remember that Gideon's story starts with the children of Israel. They have wandered from God, and because of that, he acts in ways to get their attention. And he brings some adverse consequences, specifically the Midianites, over a period of 7 years, plunder them on a repeated basis. They keep doing these raids, and anything that's good, anything that's useful, anything that's helpful, food, animal, product, whatever, they take it. The Israelites are weak. They are desperate. And finally, they turn to God. They ask God for help. And God's solution was to raise up this guy named Gideon, a young guy who has no leadership experience, from a family that is not well known or well thought of, from a tribe that is inconsequential. And from obscurity, God plucks Gideon and calls him to be the one that's going to overthrow the Midianite oppression. And the Midianites and their cronies were large. They had 135,000 soldiers. The best that Israel could come up with was 30,000, but God said that's too much. And it winds up getting whittled down, do you remember, to 300. We saw last week as Jamie was sharing how God miraculously, with 300, defeated an army of 135,000. The only way that this could be explained was the power of God and the Lord at work and this plan of His that was unfolding that gave them this victory. So how do you think Israel feels now about their state? They feel pretty good. In fact, they feel wonderful. It hasn't been this good for a long, long time. For once, in now more than 7 years, they can plant fields that somebody's not going to come in and take. They can craft equipment that somebody's not going to come in and plunder. They're going to build buildings that people aren't going to come in and tear down. They're going to be able to live in peace and harmony for the first time in years. They feel excellent about this, and the one who led them through this, Gideon, how do they feel about him? Man, Gideon is the hero. Things are looking well. Things are looking very positive. In fact, they, in verse 22, they want to honor Gideon, which is a reasonable desire. But notice what they say. They say in verse 22, "Rule over us, you as well as your sons and your grandsons, because you delivered us from the power of Midian." So what are they saying? They're saying, "Gideon, we want you to be our king." In fact, it's not just that we want you to be our king. We want you to establish a dynasty. Not the soap opera that comes on after Dallas, but we want you to establish a dynasty so that from your family, there's going to be this a monarch from your line that's going to rule over us in perpetuity. It's a lot better than saying, here's a plaque or here's a clock. I mean, they really want to honor him. Fortunately, Gideon says this in verse 23, "I will not rule over you, and my son will not rule over you." In fact, he says, "The Lord is going to rule over you." Put another way, he's saying, "I'm not going to be your king. God will be your king." And in truth, that's how it was supposed to be, because when the people came into the promised land, and as they're experiencing this, they started deciding, you know, we'd like to be like everybody else. We'd like to have a king. And they kept saying, "God, please give us a king. We want to be like everybody else. God, put somebody that we can see to rule over us." And God said, "No, you're my people. I'm your God. I will be your king." Now, finally, God is going to relent much later and going to give them a king that we know as Saul. But we're still in the period of the judges. That's much further down the road. They're still operating where the response of God is this: there is to be no king but me. God is the one who is ruling over his people, not Gideon, not Saul, not anybody else. These are God's people, and he will be their king. So when they offer to Gideon this proposition, when they say, listen, we want to honor you and give you this reign for yourself and this lineage, this legacy of a family dynasty, it's a tremendous honor. And you've got to think that would be kind of enticing. But Gideon says, nope, not going to do it. I'm not going to be your king. My kids aren't going to be your king. God's going to be your king. To that we say, gold star for Gideon. That's the right answer. He says exactly the right thing. All of that is impressive, but what does Gideon do? Unfortunately, the story continues. He says in verse 24, he says, I want to make a request of you. I want everybody to give me an earring from his plunder. And so when you conquer an enemy, you take their stuff. And so the Israelites have gotten anything of value from the Midianites, Midianites who had apparently a lot of jewelry. And so he says, give me an earring, just one earring from the plunder that you have taken. And so they start one by one throwing earrings down. And verse 26 says, the weight of gold earrings he requested wound up being 43 pounds. In case you're wondering, that's a lot of gold. In fact, by ounce, that's 688 ounces of gold. As of Tuesday, the gold trading price was $1,979 an ounce. So what they put down in front of Gideon out on the sheet or whatever it was they placed this in was $1.36 million in today's money of gold. It was a staggering amount. And what does he do? Gideon, not only does he get that, he gets these crescent ornaments, these ear pendants, the garments from the kings of Midian, because they had brought back the heads of the kings of Midian. And so verse 27 says that Gideon made an ephod from all this and put it in Ophir. What I want you to understand is this. Gideon has given the right answer. Oh, no, 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 I'm not going to be your king. In fact, no man, no human, no mortal is going to be our king. God is going to be our king. I'm just Gideon. I'm not going to be your king. But what does he do? He makes, out of the gate, financial demands that the people have to honor. You know what that kind of sounds like? Sounds like a king. And then he takes this and makes this ephod. Now, an ephod was a priestly garment. Typically, this would involve a piece of fabric that would go over the priest, and then there would be a breastplate with 12 stones representing the 12 tribes of Israel. But what seems to be going on, we don't have any more detail than what we've read here, but what seems to be going on is that they're crafting some sort of statue, some sort of memorial, some sort of monument, some sort of tribute. And a tribute to who? Well, where does this get placed? It goes in Gideon's hometown. So I'm not going to be your king, except I need you to give me some gold. Sounds kind of king-like. Oh, and with that, we're going to make a tribute, a memorial. I'm going to make a memorial to, well, me. Where could I put that? Oh, let's put it in my hometown. And what you see contextually here is that his hometown becomes the de facto capital of Israel at this point. All of this stuff sounds like what? Sounds like a king. But he said the right thing. He said, I'm not going to be your king, God will be. But then how did he act? He acted like a king. Part of the reason this story has a tragic ending is because Gideon was saying one thing, but then he was doing another. And it is important to say the right thing. It is important to communicate that which is right and true and correct. But if your actions aren't in alignment with that, that's a problem. Why is that? Well, very simply because people pay more attention to your actions than they do your words. People pay more attention to your actions than they do your words. So we've got a large family, and I don't mean this in a braggadocious way, I don't, but one of the things that I have observed is that it seems to me, generally speaking, and there's gobs of exceptions to this rule, but generally speaking, it seems that larger families tend to have better behaved children. And I believe the reason for that is simple. If you've got a child or two, you can tolerate some nonsense. In our house, if we've got six with their nonsense, somebody's going to die. And it's just too much. It's just too much. You can tolerate a little bit of it, but the more of them there are, the more that you realize we've got to lock this place down right? So we're not a perfect family. Caroline and I are not perfect parents. We don't have perfect kids, but we do operate with some intentional expectations and some consequences for failed meeting up to those expectations. And so I pay attention not only to what's going on in our life, but I pay attention to what's going on around me. And so many times it can be you're out in public. Maybe you're in a restaurant. Perhaps you're in a store. Maybe it's Black Friday shopping that you have been doing over the past couple of days. And perhaps you have seen something like this where you have some kid is an absolute tyrant that looked like Hamas kicked them out, right? And so you've got this kid just being terrible. And then you've got a mom and you've got a dad, whoever it is, they're pleading with them, please, stop doing that. If you don't do that, if you don't stop, you're going to be in trouble. You're going to be in real trouble. One, two, if you don't stop it, you're going to be in trouble. One, I feel like I'm dealing with an auctioneer that never sells. It's like one, two, and I'm like, one, two, you're going to be, one, two, and they keep counting. And I'm like, here, just let me beat them, right? But why does the kid keep misbehaving? The parent is saying the right thing. They are saying, this behavior is out of bounds, and you got to stop it. And if you don't stop it, there's going to be consequences. Is that the right thing to say? You bet it is. Is it even right to show some grace and give a little latitude and say, here's the warning? Sure, all of that's good. But why does the kid keep misbehaving? Why do they not change their behavior? It's because the child is paying attention to the action. The action says this, nothing's going to happen. They're saying it is, but it's not actually going to. And even at the youngest ages and stages in life, we pay attention to consistency. And if somebody is saying one thing and is doing another, what we do is we pay attention to their action. Gideon was saying the right thing, and he was saying, no, I will not be your king. God will be your king. He will be our monarch. He will reign over us, except I'm just going to act like one. Well, I won't be your king. You can call me your ing. Is essentially what he was doing. The story has a tragic ending because Gideon's, what he said and what he did were at odds with each other. Listen, as a mom, a dad, a grandparent, as a teenager, whatever, all of us, our story is going to have an ending. And the greatest impact of our story is not going to be of the stuff that we had, but of the relationships and the people that we had. And that's going to speak significantly about the type of legacy that we have left. And that's going to speak to whether our story has a good or a tragic ending. And I'm telling you, if you want to do your best to ensure that your story ends tragically, be inconsistent. Say the right thing, but not do it. Gideon did it, and we see how it turned out. But not only can you do that, say one thing and do another, if you want to do your best to ensure that your story ends tragically, assume things will turn out fine. Assume that things will turn out fine. So let's keep in mind what happens at the end of Gideon's life. Down in verse 33, when Gideon dies, what happens? The Israelites, they turn, they prostitute themselves by worshiping Baals and made a Baal-berith their god. So these people of God become Baal worshipers. Isn't that great? Gideon becomes effectively a punchline, and those that are his descendants, it says that they show no kindness to them. They're mean to Gideon's descendants. This guy that was the hero of the story, this guy that led them to overthrow the oppression of the Midianites, the guy that they were saying, hey, we want you to be our king, this is how the story ends. That's a tragic ending, but how does that happen? Well, it happened in part, not because, and this is not to dismiss their choices. The people of God chose to do this. I don't want to, they don't get a pass on this. But I will say this, Gideon in truth operated in ways that made this more likely. Well, how so? Well, he said, I'm not going to be your king, but he acted like he was. And not only do you see that he got all of this, so this money with the earrings, he got all this gold, which he makes a financial demand to which they comply with. Not only does that, but he keeps these purple garments. Purple garments are garments of royalty that came from the kings of Midian, the chains on the necks of the camels, that was, again, another sign of royalty, and the crescent ornaments and ear pendants, all of these were signs of Midian royalty, and who keeps those? Gideon does. I'm not going to be your king. He sure is acting like one. So, but he takes from all these earrings, melts that down, constructs this monument, this thing that looks like an ephod made out of 43 pounds of gold. And what happens in verse 27? All Israel prostituted themselves by worshiping at the arrow. You know what prostitution means. He's saying that God's people cheated on God. That which was reserved for their relationship with God, they were giving to what? This thing that Gideon had crafted. All Israel prostituted by worshiping it there, and it became a snare to Gideon and to his household. This thing that Gideon made, this guy that the people said, hey, you'll be our king, who said, no, God will be our king, has this thing crafted. It's placed in his hometown, and during his lifetime, he observes that people are doing what? They're worshiping this thing. The thing that he has made is an idol to the people. They're bowing down to this thing, perhaps bringing trinkets, perhaps bringing it food, perhaps rendering some measure of sacrifice. We don't know. But they're worshiping this thing, and Gideon sees it, and what does he do? Nothing. But the text doesn't just tell us that the people did this, but it becomes a snare to Gideon and to his own household. People, it seems, in his own family, what are they doing? They're in the hometown, they're worshiping this statue. And what does Gideon do? Nothing. Nothing. Why in the world would he do that? I think because he operated, unfortunately, like a lot of people tend to do today, a lot of even well-intentioned followers of Christ, unfortunately, a lot of times well-intentioned moms and dads, that operate under the notion, well, it doesn't make any difference what level of influence or what exposure there is. Things are going to just, they're going to turn out okay. They're going to turn out okay. We had a guy at our church in Charlotte. His name was Frank. And Frank was this older guy. He's now passed on, but he a pretty easygoing guy. And he was interesting. In fact, it was kind of funny because every time I would see Frank, it didn't make any difference what I asked. I would always get the same answer. Everything going to be all right. Frank, how you doing? Oh, everything going to be all right. Frank, you just had a heart attack. How you feel? Oh, everything going to be all right. It's been cold this week, hasn't it? Yep, everything going to be all right. I mean, anything, like that was how it started. Everything going to be all right. And it's not necessarily that he was the eternal optimist, but that was kind of what he said. And I suppose, in truth, there was some extent to which he kind of believed that. And just thinks it's just going, it's like a cat going to land on its feet. Everything's going to be all right. There are plenty of people who may not be using that statement, but there are plenty of individuals that are people of influence, that are moms and dads and grandparents, and they're teachers, and they are supervisors, and they're operating under this notion, and they're telling themselves, they may not voice it, but it doesn't make any difference what I do, how I operate. Things are just going to turn out okay. I want you to realize that every single one of us, as a follower of God, is a person of influence. And the people around us, especially those in our family, are those that we need to pay attention to. And understand this. This is a truth that's in keeping with the whole of Scripture. We come into this world with a bent towards sin. We come into this world inclined to act out of bounds, to cross the line. Left to our own devices, do you know what we do? We do things that we shouldn't. This is what you should assume. It's going to turn out terrible. If I don't act, if I don't intervene, if I don't guard the store, if I don't act intentionally, it's going to end badly. Why? Because that's what happens. left to our own devices, we are screw-ups. It was true then, it's true today, it'll be true tomorrow. Left to our own devices, that's what we're going to do. And Gideon, though he may not have said it, certainly operated as though, well, everything's going to be all right. And it wasn't. It wasn't. And here he's got in his very own hometown, maybe out, he could open his front door and see this statue that has been crafted by his own hand, and people is a stumbling block to them. It is ensnaring them. They are worshiping this, giving to it what should belong to God. And what does he do? Nothing. Assuming, well, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. And the second he's gone, what do? They become the people of Baal. Listen, if you want to ensure and do your best to determine that following you, there is a pithy legacy, and that your walk with God casts no shadow, and that you have no influence on successive generations, assume things are going to turn out fine. Because if you do, I promise you, you'll go AWOL. As you think about your life and your spheres of influence, whether it's in your home, what is it that could be ensnaring those in your own household? Maybe it's unfettered internet access that has no oversight. Maybe it is unlimited exposure to social media or TikTok or YouTube. And there's all these influences that are pouring into your kids' hearts and minds and their lives, and you just assume that it's going to have no effect. Keep doing that if you'd like a tragic ending. Personally, it could be exercising no discipline or restraint with what you entertain yourself with. Perhaps as a classmate or coworker, you practice no discipline or restraint, not simply with your language, but even with your ideas that you either tacitly express or overtly endorse. If you are interested in a positive legacy so that your story doesn't have a tragic ending, so that you have a meaningful impact not only now but after you're gone, you got to quit assuming that everything's going to be okay. Assume that it's not, and do everything in your power to secure the bases, to watch the gates of entry, to pay attention to exposure. You know, there are some advantages to be sure now that we've got two drivers in our household. Nathan and Andrew both have their driver's license. I don't know if I'm going to be able to survive doing driver's ed and riding with four more, but it just gives you a near heart attack. And it is so frustrating because the truth is, a lot of times when I get in the car, especially if it is more than a couple of minutes, I get real comfortable and sleepy. And what I'd like to do is just doze off. And it's so frustrating when you're dealing with a new driver because you can't do that. Because if you do, you will hit something. You will hit somebody. There will be a cliff that somehow you go over. And so I have to tell myself, I've got to stay awake, because I'm assuming if I don't pay attention, it's not going to work out okay. So I've got to stay engaged. I've got to stay involved. Gideon went to sleep while the other people were at the wheel. He didn't stay engaged. He didn't stay involved. And his story has a tragic ending. Listen, there are people around you that are like you in the sense that they have the capacity and the ability to make choices, choices for which they will individually ultimately be accountable for and to. But the reality is also that while you can't determine their choices, you can absolutely affect them. And your life can be one of meaningful, positive, and lasting influence so that even after you're gone, your walk with God, your commitment to the Lord, your commitment to operating within biblical standards casts a long shadow. Or not. Gideon's story had a tragic ending. My encouragement for you is to answer this. If your story ends soon, What's the legacy look like? What's the ending look like? You bow your heads with me. Everything that we've talked about today and it's easy to look back at Gideon and kind of wag our finger at him and say, shame on you, you shouldn't have done this. But even though the calendar has changed and there's lots more technology and all sorts of advancements that have been made, people are still the same. And the things that trapped up the people of God then still trap up and ensnare the people of God today. There were people in Gideon's day that assumed, hey, stuff's going to turn out okay. And they abandoned oversight. They didn't remove and guard negative influences. They would focus on saying the right thing, professing the right thing, and not paying attention to the extent that their actions were in alignment with that. It happened easily then, and it can happen and does happen easily today. Listen, is this stuff part of your story now? If you're recognizing that it is, I know that may not feel good, but I hope that that disquiet that you feel, that discomfort that you're feeling right now, that the Bible, I believe, would give this term to it, conviction. That's actually a good thing because it tells you something's wrong, and if you're aware that something's wrong, you can act in ways that fix it. So maybe what you need to do this morning is just to be honest with God and say, you know, I can give a good answer in Sunday school, and I know the right stuff. I really do, and I can talk the right stuff. I haven't been living it. And if people are indeed paying attention to what I do, I'm leading them astray, and that needs to change. Own that, confess that before God, and start making some different choices. Ask God to help you as you try to meaningfully be obedient. Maybe it is that you would say, you know what, I haven't been paying attention like I should, and that whole assuming thing, I've been doing a lot of that. And I've been doing so to the peril of those that are dearest on earth to me. And I just want to say, God, help me to see the things that may be stumbling blocks to my family that I have been ignoring. And with every opportunity you give me, help me to guard those influences, to change those things, to limit that exposure, to make some different choices. Any way that God's speaking along these lines to you, he's wanting you to respond today. Maybe he's showing you that your story could have a tragic ending because you don't have a personal connection with God. You know things about him. You know stuff from the Bible and maybe even verses from the Bible, but you don't have a personal relationship with him. If that's you, would you allow us to share with you how you can know him, to answer questions that you may have? It's going to take more than a couple of seconds. If you'd find me, find Jamie after the service is over. If you're watching online, would you reach out to us and let us talk to you on the phone, meet with you at some point, so that we can share with you a relationship with God and how it can change everything now and in the future. I'm grateful that God's word is not dead. That New Testament describes that it is active. It's living. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It tells us that it still speaks today. I believe that it has spoken today. My hope is that you've heard, but now you've got a chance to respond. So as God guides, as Karen softly plays during this time of decision, what is it that you need to say? What is it that you need to do? And will you do it? Thank you. Lord, I pray that you would help us to be people with the long view in mind. And we're not just thinking about the moment. We're thinking next month, next year, next decade. We're not just thinking about and making retirement plans, but we're thinking about what's going to happen even after we're gone. Thinking about how our story ends. What impact our life will have had. What impact it may continue to have. Gideon's story had a tragic ending. I pray that ours doesn't. And that we are people who are known to be those that walk with you, and our lives cast a long shadow that point people to the one who changed everything. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to us through your word, not only during this time, but long after we leave. We say this to you in Christ's name. Amen. Well, thank you so much for being here this morning. And if you're visiting with us, let me say thank you in particular. And I'll be at the doors at the rear of the sanctuary. I'd love to meet you and encourage you, if you haven't already, to pick up a gift and welcome packet and our welcome center as you leave. Also, just remember, we're back on normal schedule for Wednesday. So 10 o'clock in the morning, 6:15, 6:30 at night on Wednesday. So we're back on a normal schedule until the week of Christmas, I think. So the first three weeks of December, we're on a normal schedule. I know we've still got some folks that are probably away for Thanksgiving that are coming back today and probably sleepy with turkey on their bellies. So think about those that you haven't seen this morning and drop them a note, send them a card or email or something. Let them know that they were missed. In particular, thank you to Bruce and Debbie Haymore, to Carolyn Tart, to Lynn Phillips for getting our sanctuary and hallways and everything decorated for Christmas. And so they are available for hire. So if you would speak to them after, they work real cheap. I mean, real cheap. Tell them you want the Gate City deal. Anyway, it's good to see you. I'm going to ask if you would to stand. We'll be dismissed in prayer. Lord, we may not like it, but our stories here will have an end. Sooner or later. And we can't fix or determine exactly everything that's going to happen, but we can operate in ways that have a meaningful impact on what it's going to look like. Long after we leave, I just pray, God, that you cause things that we've been thinking about to rattle around in our minds, to speak to our hearts, and that even though an official time of decision as part of a service might have come to an end, the reality is you're still speaking and still inviting and still calling for decision. And I pray that we make those that cause us to have meaningful legacies that point people to you. Thank you, Lord, for changing our lives. Thank you, Lord, for changing our eternity. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us together and giving us occasion to celebrate your goodness to us. We say this with our gratitude in Christ's name. Amen.